NFAC. Right here. Black power. One more time for everybody that has died at the hands of law enforcement or died unjustly and hasn't gotten justice yet. For all the families that's out here and for somebody that knows it could be you next. Black power.
Black power.
Black power. Black power. Black power. Black power.
People in the house, well,
sermon.
Oh yeah.
Holla at your boy.
People in the house,
scream at me.
Y'all know y'all better get on up in here Friday night. Y'all know I got the smirk of I got something to tell you on my face. First of all, let's give praise to the Most High. Let's go ahead and go ahead and acknowledge the reason why we even here. Facts over feelings. Friday night in the courtroom of the opinions of our minds tonight. We got to finish up now. We are in class number 7 of the pyramid. And the Nephilim and the pyramid of the apocalypse. I mean, just think about where we've been. Not tonight. We got to take right off and get right into it. If you don't know what's going on, you in the wrong place. You better tap somebody and let them know that class number 7. This is the 7th in an 8-part series where we're doing an exegetical study on the Nephilim and the pyramid of the apocalypse by Patrick Heron and the suppositions that it puts forward and how it fits some of the arguments and some of the alternate realities and some of the explanations and some of the things that we're seeing all around the world. I got to send a big shout out to all of y'all who've been sending me all of these pictures. I mean, pictures from all over the world. Everybody is seeing something in the sky somewhere now that I got you looking up. Somebody sent me a picture today from Puerto Rico where you could clearly see sunbeams coming out of the east while the sun was setting in the west. Somebody up in the Midwest sent me what looked like two suns, looked like two, the Olympic symbol, the MasterCard symbol, didn't know what that was all about. Another person sent me what looked like something was trying to peek through the clouds, but they kept, more clouds came in. I ain't never seen so many clouds with no rain in my life. How stupid do they think we are? But it's a lot of stuff going on because he said, I will give you signs in the skies. In other words, watch the skies. We don't talked about all of that. Tonight, we are in the 7th part of the 8-part series. And if you know where we are, I got to jump right in because we got to deal with some tension that's floating through the listening congregation because a couple of people fell off in that last turn. We circled back and picked you up last time and you fell off again. So tonight we got to deal with a few things in the house. We got to deal with a couple of things on a Friday night. I hope you ain't got nowhere else to be. I hope you won't spend some time and hang out with me. You heard the song, we ain't breaking up for nothing. I'm not going nowhere. Y'all might get on my nerves sometimes. You might pluck the last nerve I had on layaway. Sometimes I got to be like Yeshua and get in the boat and say, y'all stay here. I'm going over here just me by myself just so I can get some sleep. And then I will be back. And I'm not talking to the regular folk. I'm talking to the disciples and the apostles. Those of us who are all about the liberation and putting in that work. Sometimes I got to get away from y'all just so I can go and recharge. So you can imagine what it's like when I'm trying to tell y'all that I appreciate each and every one of y'all that are putting in all this work in whatever facet that you're doing. You are appreciated. But sometimes y'all can pluck a brother's nerve and everybody knows what that feels like. And sometimes you just need a break, which leads me to the very first stop on our little train tonight. I got to ask everybody in here a question before we can proceed with the rest of the Nephilim and the Pyramid of the Apocalypse. The question that I want to pose as we start this evening session, because I'm going to be with you for a while, and you know I'm in love with you, I ain't going nowhere, so you might as well go and get comfortable with me and turn me up on your job so you can offend your coworkers that are walking around with fake masks on, pretending like you all are equal when they're calling you the N-word behind your back. Yeah, I'm going to say it. And then don't forget that if you're hanging out with some people that want to make you feel like you all-inclusive, well, if they really all-inclusive, turn us on and let's see if they don't all get this funny look on their face. It's about the same thing I'm hearing right now, that people who spending their hard-earned dollars buying NFAC shirts and hoodies are going out and people are having strange reactions. They're not saying, hey, that's a great shirt. They're not saying, you know what, I'm glad to see black folks are finally unifying. They're not saying, hey, I may not be one of you, but I still support you. That's not what they're getting. Instead, they're getting, how dare you come up in here with that terrorist outfit on? You know, I had somebody interview me tonight and they tried to slide this question in. It says, there have been a lot of reports that you all are anti-Semitic. What do you say? I had to cut her off, shut her down, pack her up and put her ass back in the box and send her right down the street. I said, let me explain something to you. I said, first of all, I'm going to say the same thing that you have been saying to everybody else. Don't come in here trying to play dumb like you don't know. We ain't never said nothing like that. You can't show me where nobody said nothing like that, because I ain't said nothing like that. We're not listed as a hate group. We're not listed as a group of terrorists, because if we was, the Southern Poverty Law Center would have us on the list. We are not on the list, which means we ain't done nothing, which means I ain't said nothing, which means you ain't talking about nothing. If this is what you want to interview me about, then you need to go ahead, because I don't do petty. She didn't know what to say. She was stuck. She was, what will I, these things? No, these things are important to you. Let's talk about our successes. Let's talk about the atmosphere that precipitated our creation. Let's talk about the rising tension since a certain individual been in the White House for 4 years and said it was okay for white nationalism to come back. Let's talk about that. Let's talk about the fact that we're the response to the problem. We're not the problem. Let's talk about that. But instead, they don't want to talk about that. They just want to make sure, like, let me tell you, I got to share this with y'all. They had the audacity to ask your boy. They said, those guns that you all carry, I mean, are those real guns? And would you use them, or are they just for show? Who in the, see, that shows you the cultural disconnect. In their culture, they think it's okay to walk around with all that hardware and you not going to use it. They don't know black people, do they? Y'all better talk to me. That's why this is a pro-black channel. That's why this is a pro-black broadcast. I know I broke the internet last night when I did this. I'm probably going to break it again tonight, but that's okay. I'm still in my intro. Y'all stay with me. We just getting ready. Go ahead and get the popcorn out the microwave and go ahead and put me on the flat screen. Turn on the surround sound and adjust the sub bass. We're going to knock in here tonight on behalf of the Most High. Somebody going to learn something before they walk out of here on a Friday night. I want you to stay with me no matter what I do, no matter where I go, no matter what curb I take. Y'all going to have to hang out with me and hang on tight, because I'm going to say some things tonight that's going to get some people pissed off, and they're going to say, I can't believe he had the audacity to say that after I've been brainwashed for all these years. Don't you know I'm comfortable in my brainwash? Nobody ever had a brainwash like this. It's in there real deep. You can't get it out. It hurts when you pull it out. You can't do that to me. How dare you reach inside and pull out my brainwash here on the internet? It's Friday night. I'm supposed to be on my job. I'm over here in the corner taking an extra long break because you all up in my business. Well, the reason I'm in your business is because it's time. And if I am in your business, it means you're a chosen one. And if you were chosen, you were chosen for a reason. And if you were chosen for a reason, that means it's time for you to activate. It's time for you to let go of your doubt. It's time for you to stop denying who you really are. It's time for you to stop letting other people control you. You got to stop letting people intimidate you. Don't let nobody talk you out of your dream. It's your dream. It's not theirs. Your dream might be a nightmare to somebody else. Don't think that everybody that pats you on your back and that's giving you dap and telling you that's what's up is happy that you're coming up. A lot of people aren't like that. They like what they see. They don't like who they see it on. Let me say that again. There's people around you. Get a new car. Get promoted at your job. Buy a new house and watch a lot of people say, that's a nice car. They're not happy that you got the car. They appreciate the car, but they really wish your ass didn't have it. See, there's a difference between jealousy, envy, and covetousness. See, when you're jealous of somebody, you just don't want them to have some. But when you envy what they have, not only do you want what they got, or you might not want what they got, but you don't want them to have it. And that is the epitome of a black heart. And that's a lot of times what we're dealing with. So I have to pose this question. Do you know him? No, y'all ain't hear me. I mean, we really got to deal with this because it's causing a lot of confusion. See, a lot of y'all claim that you believe in the Most High. You quick to say all praise to the Most High. Come out your mouth quick. But then your actions say otherwise. So I have to ask you, do you really know him? Here's why I say that. Hold on, because I don't want nobody to get all bent out of shape. Watch him now. Stay with your boy. You see, when we talk about who sent the Kodesh Matakim and the Watchers to intermingle with the earth women to produce the Nephilim offspring that corrupted everything on earth, the seed and everything that caused the first destruction for them to then come back. We then start talking about Seth all the way to Noah because we got to talk about them. And then we talk about what happened to the Nephilim offspring because most of y'all don't realize that the holy books that you're reading are written from one perspective. There's always two sides to an argument. There's the stories. The winners got a story, but the losers got a story too. And you never hear the loser story. You always hear the winner's story. Just like in America, we're taught the winner's history. They don't teach us our history. They teach us the history about since they came over here, raped, robbed, and stole every damn thing, got themselves together at your expense, took over everything, made themselves rich, and then they want to write a book and teach it to you. This is history. No, that's your history. See, there's always two sides. And when you're in the slave master's church, when you have been indoctrinated into the religion that they want to have you in the Western society so you believe as they believe, so even though it runs counterculture to everything that you have in Africa, you still are over here practicing something that was taught to you by some people that are not your culture, but you will defend it to the death because you don't know what goes in the middle of it. The problem with that is if you knew both sides of the story. If somebody told you what I'm telling you now, 10, 15 years ago, you wouldn't be where you are right now. I guarantee you that somebody listening to me right now, half the stuff I teach on here, if somebody has set you down 5 or 10 years ago and broke it down for you like this, you wouldn't be where you are right now. I'm not saying you wouldn't still be quarantined, not saying you wouldn't still be a victim of the pandemic, but your whole life would be completely different if somebody was fair and told you the truth. Can I teach in here? Friday night, right here, facts over feelings, scared me going around the first curve, hold on. So therefore, because we know there's two sides to every story, you got to go back and you got to look at the books that were taken out, not the books that's still in. If I'm trying to convince the jury that it was Miss Taylor's fault that she got shot, I'm going to leave out certain information about the crimes that the other officers did so the grand jury does not have to consider whether or not they should bring charges against those people for killing that young lady by leaving things out. Somebody say, I didn't see that one coming. They've done the same thing with the scriptures, y'all. This is nothing new. The playbook don't change. When are y'all going to understand that those who are descendants of the Edomite line, they don't change. They warned you about them. You didn't heed the warnings. You act like this stuff don't apply to you. You want to act like it's ancient history, but it's happening right now in front of your face. It says right there in 1 John 2:3-6, it says, whoever says that they know God, yet do not follow his commands is a liar and the truth is not in them. Quote, unquote, look it up yourself. It says that we know that anyone, that's born of Yahweh, that does not continue to sin. The one who is born of Yahweh keeps them safe, and the evil one, Satan, cannot harm them. So you already walking in a situation. Now, this is the part that kills me in this whole discussion. That's the individual that set all of this other stuff in motion that got us arguing in the first place. The master puppeteer himself. Oh, you know him well. But if I start calling out all his names, some of y'all will get confused. You know why you'll get confused? Because if I go to the book of, not the book that they told you, but the book that the losers wrote. Because see, the losers had lost. A lot of people who watch the white man's interpretation, did y'all ever notice in the Ten Commandments that after Moses left with all of the slaves and they were gone, the Hebrew, they gone now, the last time they show you the Pharaoh, what was he doing? Sitting on the throne talking about his God is God. And then he fade away. You don't see him no more. That's it. It's a wrap. They gone. Remember that? You're like, that's it? The Egyptians don't exist no more? And then the rest of the story is focused on them walking around in a damn circle. They walked in 9 miles for 40 years. They go and went 9 miles for 40 years until they could kill off the generation of knuckleheads. They went 9 miles for 40 years so they could kill off all the haters and the Uncle Toms and the Coons and the Sambo. They went 9 miles. They didn't go nowhere. They just walked around in a goddamn circle 9 miles for 40 years until some people was dead and gone. And then they could go into the land of Canaan, which was at the time occupied by the Nephilim. Can I teach black people black history? It's giants back in them days. Real giants. And not just big people. These hybrid creatures called the Nephilim. Half human, half spirit beings. Evil. Descendants of the fallen angels. There was a war against them, and most of them were killed. But the ringleaders, supposedly, are imprisoned in a place called Tartarus. That, if you read the first book of Enoch with Yahweh's name restored, does a pretty good job of giving you a world tour of the world, because he was considered to be the scribe of Yahweh. Yahweh hand chose him to say, you're going to be the scribe. I want you to write down everything that you see so we can get this whole thing sorted out so everybody will know exactly what happened. Now, if you don't understand how important it was for someone to be, let's say, the scribe, as they called it, then you'd have to understand the order. And the order is exactly what it is. It is the order that everyone lives in inside of this particular hierarchy. They had a hierarchy. If you were a scribe, you weren't just somebody that sat around that when they needed you, they called you and said, hey, come up here, scribe, and write something for me. It didn't work that way. It didn't work that way at all. As a matter of fact, the scribe was one of the highest jobs that you could have inside of the Pharaoh's kingdom. Let me break it down for you, because some of y'all probably have never heard this done before. I'm going to do this one time. I don't normally do this, but since we're talking about it, and I'm a teacher, everything I know before I have to go, because I won't be with you. But a little while longer, we got some things we got to do. I just can't sit in the classroom. But at the very bottom of the sociological scale were the slaves. Yes, that was the slaves. Point blank. Slaves. Slaves were they were at the very, very bottom, and nobody, they were less than human, and nobody cared if they died. Their life was made bitter bondage, and I'm the slaves. Above a slave was a peasant. Then the peasant was broke. Peasant was scrambling, trying to make it, but he wasn't no slave. And then above them was the craftsman. Those were people who knew how to do things with their hands. They could build things. They could grow things. They handle agriculture and all kind of stuff. He had some peasants who was farmers too, but they wasn't balling like the craftsman. The craftsman was building quality stuff. And then above them was the merchants. Those were the people who sold and bought stuff. The store owners, the business folks. They was the next ones up on the totem pole. They had it pretty good. And then watch this. The next people above them was the soldiers. Yeah, the soldiers. The soldiers had more pull than the merchants, the craftsmen, the peasants, and the slaves. So if you was a soldier, you was balling out of control. That's why you could walk around and do what you wanted to do. Put somebody to death and wouldn't nobody care about it. The same attitude that police today have towards citizens. You would think we was back in ancient Egypt some damn where, and they thought that they were soldiers, and that we had the merchants and the craftsmen and the peasants. And oh, and then above them were the scribes. The scribes were the ones who recorded history. The scribes were the one who saw everything. So for Enoch to be chosen as the scribe of Yahweh, that was a high honor. So who's above the scribe? Well, then you have government officials, the priests and the viziers, and then above them you had the Pharaoh. And then above the Pharaoh, now we get into some interesting characters, because who would be above the Pharaoh? Who put the Pharaoh in power? Where did the Pharaoh get his power from? Because when we think of the Pharaoh, we've been brainwashed to think just Egypt, but the Pharaoh was put in power by somebody else. Now we got a gap between who put the Pharaoh in power and what happened to the Nephilim. Nobody wants to deal with this. We're going in full steam. Let's go. You want me to believe the story all the way going back before the flood and all of this and Enoch and this, that, and the third? We came through the flood and we got Seth and Shem and all of this. You want to believe Moses and all of this stuff happened? I got you. We rolling with all of that. But then when we get into Egypt, everything goes into a black hole and all of a sudden, boop, we got this whole new world where you're talking about 25 dynasties of some of the most advanced, the golden age of blacks in Kemet, northern Egypt and southern Egypt and Mesopotamia. You're talking about Ethiopia and the Catholic. You're talking about all of this stuff like it popped up out of nowhere, but you'll never fill in the gap between what happened between the biblical lineage that we can verify that came out of those people who came out of the ark, and then the gap, they're still in the same place. What was going on at that time that y'all don't want to talk about? Why don't you want the people to know the truth? Why are you mixing up all these names? Why? Didn't you think that in the end they would send somebody to clear it all up? Don't you ever wonder why they said we will make them in your image? He didn't say I'm gonna make man in my image. He says, come let us make man in our image, which means you look like, you talk like, you walk like, you even smile like, but you're not one. You are a representation that has received bad information. And now the time has come for there to be some expiation. If you don't know what that means it's going to be some bloodshed. But the right blood has to be spilled, not the wrong. And you don't want your blood spilled out of ignorance. So when I say names like Aspa and Tiamat and Anshar and Kishar and Anu and Enlil and Enki and the Anunnaki, you shouldn't sit there and say, what is the Enuma Elish? Because if you ask me those questions, then you have demonstrated to me that you are ignorant to the bridge that goes from biblical record as you believe it, all the way into Egyptian records as you have been retaught, which gives a clue to the foundation of who you are, black people. And no one has to argue with you about whichever tribe of the 12 you came from, because if you can fill in the gap and understand the lineage and the bloodlines and the mixing of the bloodlines and all of the sprouting races that came off of it, then you would understand why they want to keep you at the bottom of that pyramid, why they want to commit genocide. You know the pyramid of racism. I know y'all know the pyramid of race. We have all heard about the pyramid of racism, the pyramid of white supremacy. How many of y'all have never, in your, this generation has never had nobody break down for y'all the pyramid of white supremacy? I know when I was young, somebody sat me down and broke down the pyramid of white supremacy. So let me go ahead and break it down for all the young. This is for the young folks. See, let me show you how you read this, youngins, because old folks, they understand. Let me help y'all out real quick. This is what your pops would do when everybody pops would set them down. I'm going to do y'all right now. So brothers and sisters, little queens and kings, check this out. The first level, remember, it's a pyramid now. So we're going to start at the bottom. The first level of white supremacy is they adopt this attitude of indifference towards you. They'll say stuff like, politics don't affect me. They'll say racist jokes right in front of you. They'll see if you're going to challenge them. They're going to avoid confrontation with racist family members. They know their daddy racist as hell, but they ain't going to say nothing. They're indifferent about it. They're apolitical about it. They figure like racism don't affect them. That's the first sign. When you see somebody that's of the white race and they got this indifferent attitude, no, it ain't no thing, bro. You know, it's But your daddy racist. No, that's just the way he is. The next level behind that is what we call minimization. And that's where they start saying stuff, trying to smooth shit over. Like, you know, we all belong to the human race. You know what I'm saying? They have a white savior complex. They want to be your allies. They want to join up with you. They deny that there's white privilege. They say, why can't we all just get along? They believe that we're in a post-racial society. They'll say something. It don't matter who you vote for, just as long as you vote. They always want to be the white ally speaking at the top of black civilizations. Them the ones that's going to tell you, say, oh, it's just a joke. Them the ones that's going to tell you, get over slavery. Them the ones that's going to say, not all white people. Them the ones going to say this is a false equivocation, that what you're hearing is not what you're hearing. The next level is what we're seeing now. It's called veiled racism. That's when they're being racist, but they're trying to hide behind something. I'm teaching young folks now. That's when you see victim blaming. Well, what did you do to make him call you that? You know what I'm saying? There's paternalism. Let me talk to you, youngin'. Let me tell you something. Hold on, I'm not your son, first of all, okay? And it's English only. If you're going to speak to me, you got to speak English, you know? Then you have what we call the bootstrap theory. Well, I don't know why y'all can't get yourself together. We done picked ourselves up. Y'all got to pick yourself up by your bootstraps too, but ignore the fact that y'all never gave us no boots or no bootstrap to pick ourselves up. And when we did, you came and burnt them back down and put us back in the hole. So don't tell me to pick up my bootstraps when you over here cheating every time I do get some boots or some straps to pull up by. Can you say Black Wall Street? That's veiled racism. Tone policing. Cultural appropriation is a form of veiled racism. When someone imitates what you do, whether they're making fun of it or whether they're just doing it to take the glory and the money away from you, that's a form of racism. So y'all keep giving away the culture to these people, and it's veiled racism is what they're doing. Then we get to the next level. Discrimination. Straight up discrimination, things like mass incarceration of black people, racial profiling by the police, hiring discrimination when they know that you qualify for the job, the fearing people of color. As soon as you walk in, everybody locking their damn doors and pulling down slate, racial slurs. Some people straight out call you the N-word just to see what you can do. They're not giving funds to the schools appropriately. They don't give funds to the black schools. Black schools struggling for pens and paper. They got anti-immigration policies that pop up out of nowhere all of a sudden. They didn't have these anti-immigration policies when it was more of them, but as soon as there's more of anybody else, all of a sudden it's an anti-immigration policy. You get what I'm saying? They used to have policies like stop and frisk, talking about they doing it in the name of the law. They do redlining, where they'll draw a line right around your house so that your neighborhood don't have no voting power and you can't get no brand new street lights. That's discrimination. And then the level above that is where you start to see little bits and pieces, calls for violence. That's when you got your neo-Nazis and your KKK and your Antifa and people driving around with Confederate flags and they burning crosses and swastikas. That's what birthed the NFAC. You see how far up the chain they got? They went from indifference to minimization to veiled racism to outright discrimination to now they got calls for violence. All hell to the gnaw. Hey, bro, suit up, boot up. We got to pull up. The next level above that is where they're afraid that everybody's going. And that's the next in the pyramid of white supremacy. That's violence, unjust police shootings, lynchings, hate crimes. We already there. Don't you know what's at the very top? Because there's one more level above that in the pyramid of white supremacy. The final stage is genocide. Straight white males, Chinese males, mass murder. Now I just taught you the pyramid. Of white supremacy. The higher you climb in this pyramid, the more special interest groups prosper under this patriarchy. These are listed for you to examine anywhere if you open your eyes and just study. These are the things that you would much rather somebody tell you than you learn firsthand, because the lesson is not pretty, especially when you start to realize who actually runs this world. I wasn't going to get into this, but I'm teaching my young folks. Can I break it down to you? I mean, y'all really want to know the truth about who runs this world, who really, really runs this world. But let me tell you this, at the bottom of the pyramid, below the pyramid, you will find corporations such as Monsanto and world leaders and politicians that are below them. At the bottom, you'll find 99.99% of the population is underneath the bottom level of the pyramid. At the 13th level, you got your secret societies. At the 12th level, you got the Committee of 300. At the 11th level, you got the Council of the 13. At the 10th level, you got the United Nations. At the 9th level, you have the Federal Reserve and all the other central banks. At the 8th level, you have the United Nations Banking Complex. At the 7th level, you have the Council on Foreign Relations. At the 6th, oh, I'm going to tell it all tonight. At the 6th level, you got the Business Advisory Council. At the 5th level, you got the Bilderberg Group. At the 4th level, you got the Vatican and the Roman Catholic Church. At the 3rd level, that's your lower level malevolence and all of those people that y'all don't think are all the way human. And might, some people even say that they might have some aliens thrown in there. That's how exotic it is. Some Dracos and some reptilians sliding around in there. At the 2nd level, you're supposed to have all your higher level malevolent beings on this planet. That means that everybody that's the brightest of the bright, the most evil of the evil, the most devil worshiping of the most, the ones who are closest to the Nephilim, the ones that still are in contact with all of those spirits that were cast down, those who have a direct contact to the Kodesh Matakim on the dark side, like straight out of Star Wars. At the 1 level, you have what we would call, and I know y'all can't comprehend this, but they're what you call archons, invisible matter. I know this sounds crazy. Do your research. Don't you know that the highest level malevolence who literally exist and feed off of you, feed off of fear, death, pain, suffering, misery, sacrifices, and control. Don't you know that? That's what sits at the top, and that's why this world stays miserable like it does, and they gave you all the clues and the keys to avoid it, but most of y'all done got mesmerized by the pixie dust. Most of y'all done sat there and drank the Kool-Aid. A lot of y'all aren't even pro... You can't... Listen, if I told you that way, 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 way back, way, 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 way back, there was a god by the name of Asper, crisscrossed with a god by the name of Tiamat. And those words literally mean heaven and earth. And they birthed Anshar and Kishar. And Kishar and Anshar birthed Anu. Anu went on to be known as Father God. A lot of y'all don't know that. His name literally means the crown on the throne. And of course, he hooked up with another goddess by the name of Uras, and they had these two little dudes. And this is where we're going to focus tonight, Enlil and Enki. And we're going to talk a little bit about, am I my brother's keeper? Yes, am I my brother's keeper? And this is where we sat down in the Nephilim and the Pyramid of the Apocalypse. Now, as we've talked throughout this series, I've examined the fact that the Nephilim did, in fact, were responsible for many of the events that are told, whether they're in Holy Scripture, whether they're told in historical books, or whether they're any of the archaeological finds, indicates that something massive happened back in the day. Yes, that much we all know. The question then becomes, are these part of some type of spiritual occurrences that are connected to the Most High, or is this just things that happened on earth and we just overreading into it? Even though it says that in order for us to understand these things, we have to be able to look at the proof of what's right in front of us. Can I keep it a little local for you? We ain't got to go to Egypt. Let's stay right here in America. Mm-hmm. Matter of fact, Chi-Town, stand up, because if you leave your house and go south in Illinois and continue all the way down, you're going to run into a place that even extends all the way to St. Louis. And the name of it was a city called Cahokia was a city that extended from southern Illinois across the Mississippi River all the way to St. Louis. They said this city was so big, it had 50,000 people that lived there. The city of Cahokia was one of those large places that they destroyed when they invaded North America. They wiped out the entire civilization. They don't teach you that in class. I went to this place because I had to see it for myself. Because I read that there was a pyramid there that was bigger than the one in Egypt. Of course, I didn't believe that, so I had to go check it out for myself. Went to St. Louis and drove out of St. Louis and drove east. And sure enough, I saw a big old sign that said, you can pull over right here and pull over to the World Heritage Site for Cahokia. So I said, okay, I'm going to check it out. It's early in the morning, kind of cold out there. And it looked like it was a pyramid that was missing its top. But what amazed me were the steps to ascend to its top. There were a lot of them. And the way it was built, it didn't go up. Kind of went, you know, like that. So it was taking you up, but it was doing it smoothly. And I'm trying to picture who mounted these steps and for what reason did you have to mount all these goddamn steps? What's going on here? So, you know, of course, walking in the spirit of the ancestors, I'm going to take the walk too. I know I'm feeling myself. I'm going to walk on up here. Like I don't got into character, not knowing the history of the grounds I'm standing on, not knowing what they did there however many thousands of years ago, not knowing what spiritual connections they may have had. I'm just all full of me, like I'm going to walk up here because I'm worthy. And I start to mount the steps, and I had my phone with me, and I mounted the steps. And when I got to the top of the steps, the view on top of that pyramid, I could see not only all of St. Louis, I could see past St. Louis. St. Louis looked small, and I could see miles in any direction. And I said, oh my God, this was a power trip. So I started to walk to the center of the pyramid, and I pulled out my phone because I wanted to take pictures and record myself on the top of this pyramid. And my phone wouldn't work. It shut off, and I turned it back on, and it shut back off, and I turned it back on again, and it came up and it froze and it cut back off. So I'm thinking, I got a bug in my phone. I've caught a virus. So now I'm pissed off because I got a virus. So instead of, you know, trying to fix it, I left the pyramid. I went down the steps and back to my car, and my phone worked just fine. At that moment, I began to respect that pyramid. Because I don't know anything or didn't know anything about that civilization. And the damn sure haven't taught us anything in any educational class. They teach you, oh, they're just mounds. No, you destroyed a civilization that was here, a very advanced civilization, just about as advanced as the one that there was that you destroyed in Egypt. So apparently this didn't just happen in just the Middle East. But for the purposes of what we're talking about now, I have to be very careful when I make you all understand that there was a global civilization at the time of the Nephilim and the Pyramid of the Apocalypse. We've already talked about that. The interesting thing is that we are dealing with a species that believes that they have the power to play God. You all remember Stephen Hawking. Stephen Hawking was the genius. He bet a guy by the name of Gordon Cain $100. That physicists would not discover what's called a Higgs boson. He lost that bet. A lot of people don't know what this is, but the theory is of a Higgs boson is where we have, and this gets a little complicated, is a quantum fluctuation particle that creates a vacuum bubble that will extend through space and wipe out the universe as we know it. In other words, a doomsday particle. And these idiots were sitting around betting $100 on who could invent one. And then what would you do with it? I mean, that's the epitome of the destruction of everything that Yah has made. Someone done sat there and figured out, how could I destroy everything? Well, who do you think, whose child is it that you think is talking? That is not the child of anybody who is a child of the king. I'm going to cut to the chase. Am I my brother's keeper? Enki and Elil were the proponents of the first pyramid war that you never hear of. This was back in the year 8970 BCE. That's when the factions, see, they had factions. They had their own armies that they had built. Enki and Elil, they went and they were in the first pyramid war. And this is a story that a lot of people don't talk about. This is the story of Horus, who was avenging his father's Osiris and the banishment of Seth from Egypt. And although the Sinai Peninsula, where the Anunnaki spaceport was established and the Giza pyramids were supposed to remain neutral under the aegis of Narsag, it's doubtful whether the builders of these facilities, Enki and his descendants, had really any intention of relinquishing control. So they fought over it. Now, I done said a bunch of stuff that people are like, what? A spaceport? The Anunnaki? What the hell are you talking about, Jay? I thought you were trying to tell us that we was the children of the Most High. You are the children of the Most High, trapped on Earth with a bunch of hybrids called Nephilim, who also set a bunch of shit in motion that some of y'all have confused as the worship of the Most High. Can I teach? You can't go nowhere with all this junk in your mind. Somebody say, I'm going to slap my pastor tomorrow. So we have to stay focused, folks, because there's some things that have happened back in history that they just didn't tell you. And now we have to come back and reset the table so that we can move on in the story. Now, I'm going to go ahead. If you got your copy of the Nephilim and the Pyramid and Apocalypse, you might want to follow along because I'm going to touch on two things real quick. Okay, the first thing I want to touch on is that when people hear this type of teaching, it is against what they have already been brainwashed. When people hear the truth for the first time, when you've been believing a lie, yes, it's going to scare you. Yes, it's going to shake you, but it's supposed to, because it is the freeing of you that is actually starting to happen. It's getting inside, not just your ear, but in your soul. This makes sense. What they were talking about down the street didn't make no sense. Didn't you ever wonder why you was the only one sitting there that never caught the Holy Ghost? People rolling around on the floor, talking in tongues, jumping up and down, getting carried out on oxygen tanks, getting resuscitated, they getting zapped in the head by unseen bolts of electricity, and you sitting there like, okay, now am I the only one who did? I heard everything y'all heard, right? And something is not resonating with me. I submit this to you. The model is always going to be the same. We as black people will never be able to unite until first we learn that the very basic unit of unity is just two of us. There are always just two of us. I guarantee if I put any two of us in one room together, one of us will pick a reason to hate the other. If I put any three of us in a room, two of us will find a reason to get together to hate the other person. The unit of unity is two. That's why in every story, Enki and Enlil, Cain and Abel, it's always two people. And what happens? Somebody gets pissed off and kills the other person. They're telling you the same story. They're just telling it to you different ways. No matter what epic you read, no matter which biblical scripture you read, no matter which Egyptian tablet you read, whether it's Thoth or anybody else, whether it's some mystical planet or some mystical spirit, whether it's Zeus and the Greeks, it's always two people and somebody killing somebody, because they're trying to show you that the real crime happened back in the Garden of Eden when we found out that Aziel, who was one of the fallen angels, did the nasty with Eve, and so she ended up having Cain. He wasn't Abel's brother, he was his half-brother. He was evil, he was malevolent. That's why he killed his brother, because that's what's in his blood. That's what's in his DNA. And then when y'all found out about it and found out what was going on, he already knew how the whole thing was going to end. So he had to banish him away. And of course he does. And he goes out and populates with who? Where do you think the rest of these mystery people came from? I already told y'all last night that Lucifer had made up his mind that the only way that he could sabotage the plan was that he had to populate the earth too with some evil people. So when he went out, who the hell you think he was linking with? More evil people. So it's in your blood. You can't help yourself. So when people start saying, so you're going against what we've already been taught, that means you're the Antichrist. Am I? Well, let's examine that. The word anti means instead and not against, as most people think. So this man who will be directly controlled by Satan is instead of Christ. He's instead of Christ. He's not Antichrist. He's going to give you an alternative to Christ. He's going to give you maybe the truth or maybe a lie. But when the truth sayers show up, don't confuse them with the other instead of. You'll be able to spot the fakes real quick because you will know them by their works. They will not be able to assemble the masses. They will not be able to move the animals. They will not be able to steal the waters. They will not be able to speak directly on behalf of the Most High flawlessly. They will not be gifted with the ability to interpret and exegete all religions and the commonality of that which is the Creator. They will not have that ability. You will sit in front of them and you will think that it's an act because it looks so smooth. It's spiritual, which is exactly what you are, but you're trapped in your flesh. He will be the devil's Messiah, as it were. He will have a brief but eventful reign in the earth lasting for 7 years. And from the beginning of the great tribulation, this man will rise very fast on the world's political stage. And he will attain tremendous power and influence. And he will be the head of a confederacy of 10 extremely rich and powerful kingdoms. And he will be the most charismatic and eloquent of all leaders. And the world will love him. And he will talk peace, but he'll wage war. Most, but not all, will be deceived into thinking that he is the one who can bring peace to the world. How is this man going to gain such power? That's where the book leaves off. They say, when you see that, Know the difference between the real and the fake. And don't throw the real away because you can't believe that nothing but the fake is going to show up to you. You see, a lot of us, we play the victim role so much that when we really don't even believe we deserve a blessing no more. Do y'all, how many of y'all remember the video where I was talking to the homeless guy in Hollywood and he said that everybody deserved a blessing and he figured that everybody had threw him away. And I said, there's no such thing as throwaway people. Y'all didn't make throwaway people. You can't throw away his greatest work just because your soul is dark and black. It goes on further to say that whoever this instead of Christ will be is going to emerge as the man to lead the world in prosperity and peace after some global catastrophe. We've had a global catastrophe. We've had the pandemic. They says one way or another, this man will gain unprecedented worldwide political and military power. So whoever this person is going to be is not only going to be an eloquent politician, they're going to be one hell of a warrior on the battlefield. It's not going to be one or the other. It's not going to be just somebody with all guns and that's it. And it's not going to be somebody that can rightly divide the word and talk the language and code switch with all of the politicians for his people. It's going to be someone who's a combination of both. And the people will demand it. It's not something that's going to have to be forced on them. When they start trying to vaccinate you against your will by sending the military in your house, when they start telling you, you got to take the ID chip, otherwise you can't fly on a plane or you can't do nothing, you can't eat, you can't sell, you can't do nothing. When they come around trying to tell you that your kids can't stay with you because somebody done told them that you might be COVID, when all that shit start popping off, you're not going to have somebody come along and twist your arm and say, we got to get together, unite and fight against this shit. You will jump on board real quick. And I ain't been wrong yet. Now, it's three things that the Creator is having a hard time with everybody about right now. And y'all already know, you shout when I call yours out. Pride, fullness of bread, abundance of idleness. Let's go and break that down. Pride, must I say it? Y'all spend more time being proud of yourself, not your race, yourself, than anything else. Stay in the mirror, always trying to put more on what he's already created. You're proud. You're proud of yourself. Proud of what you got. Proud of what you done. Just proud. Got a proud look. No. Fullness of bread. Yeah. It means that, you know, y'all got so much, everything's overflowing. You ain't think about nobody else. People starving around the world, but you ain't got nowhere else to put no food. And then on top of that, you got too much time on your hands. Abundance of idleness. Y'all ain't got nothing to do. I'm quarantined. I can't do nothing. Really? You'd be surprised what you can do inside your mind while you're sitting inside your house. If you do nothing with your mind, it doesn't make a difference whether you're in the house or not, does it? These are the things that will be taken advantage of by whoever this individual is. And then most importantly and lastly, I want to end on this note right here on this particular piece. Most people don't understand. Watch this. Here we go. Hold on, y'all. Hold on. Everybody got everybody's hands. Here we go. We're going over the top. We're going right now. Most people never get into the side of the story where we talk about the women angels. See, most people don't think about women angels. Throughout this entire story of the Nephilim, you have heard about the men copulating with the females to produce the Nephilim. But that doesn't mean that all they had were males. And that doesn't mean that, oh, I sit here, come, it's going to mess with you. It doesn't mean that all of the 200 watches that fell to earth were male. Let that vibrate in for a minute. Mm-hmm. Let me read a scripture to you from the book of Enoch. It said, and I, Enoch, alone saw the vision, the end of all things, and no man shall see as I've seen. And I saw a deep abyss with columns of heavenly fire. I'm somewhere in the book of Enoch, somewhere around chapter 13, verse 3, if y'all want to jump on with me. And I saw a deep abyss with columns of heavenly fire. And I saw there seven stars like great burning mountains. And to me, when I inquired regarding them, the angel said, this is the place is the end of heaven and the end of earth. And this has become a prison for the stars and the host of heaven. And the stars which roll over the fire are they which have transgressed the commandments of the Lord in the beginning of their rising. The stars can get in trouble. Come on, the stars getting in trouble? You think you in trouble? The star is in trouble. What did the star not do? They say the star was not where it was supposed to be at the appointed time per the grand plan that Yahweh had ordered when he releases them from the six gates. If you don't know that, go study up on the luminaries. And they weren't on time and be where they're supposed to. They go into fourth heaven. Remember, there are 10 heavens. Yahweh sits on seventh heaven, but on fourth heaven is where they imprison the stars and the angels that are awaiting judgment. You got angels sitting around waiting on judgment. So what makes you think you ain't gonna get sitting around waiting on judgment? You better stop believing that bullshit talking about even heaven looking down on us. You wish it was that simple, don't you? If it was that simple, then we wouldn't need to put all this together. We wouldn't have to go through all of this. There wouldn't have to be all of this development. There wouldn't have to be all of these classes. You wouldn't have to sit here and have somebody break down the truth for you. You wouldn't have to sit here and get the wool pulled over your eyes. If it was that simple, it's not that simple. It ain't never been that simple. You get reminders, you get clues. Hell, you even get signposts along the way that tell you when you made it this far. You ever had deja vu? That means you made it that far. It does. You are, I've been in here before. I don't know why. This looks familiar. Yeah, of course it's familiar. You made it that far last time. Keep pushing. And then maybe you'll graduate from the class. He goes on to say, and he was wroth with them and bound them till time when their guilt would be consummated for 10,000 years. And Uriel, remember, he's one of the Kodesh Matakim, he said to me, here shall stand the angels who have connected themselves with women in their spirits, assuming many different forms, defiling mankind, and shall lead them astray into sacrificing to demons till the day of great judgment, in which they shall be judged till they are made an end of. And the women also of the angels who went astray shall become sirens. I'm not making this up. Y'all really need to put y'all head in these ancient books and look at it. It's right in front of your face. Somebody even said, how can you hide the truth from black people? Just put it in a book. Why? Because they don't read no more. People used to get killed for reading. And now the information is right in front of your face. So let's go ahead and talk a little bit. And this right here is kind of, I'm sorry, there's no other way for me to describe it. This is downright freaky for bro to sit there. You mean to tell me there's some women angels? You mean my guardian angel could be a woman? I'm being watched over by a woman angel? This is interesting. How does she know what's best for me? Shut up. She got the job. She's assigned to watch over your soul. Yeah, but she's a woman. It doesn't make a difference. She's spiritual. But I mean, I'm a man. No, just your body is male. You don't know what the sex of your soul is. You could have came back last time as a woman. Don't tell me that. I'm all messed up now. Well, that's the way it is. Stop trying to worry about, as long as you got an angel, be glad of that. I'm just saying, when shit be happening, you mean to tell me I got... So now, think about that. They never talk to you all about the women angels, women messengers, women watchers, women who are members of the Kodesh Matakim. Here we're told that women angels who went astray, they went astray too. It wasn't just their brothers. I'm sorry, I have to really ask myself, and I got to ask y'all, what kind of people was you making back then that the angels came out and be like, man, you know damn well, he put some work in this. I don't know, I ain't going to be the work here. Enoch was, or rather is, they say is because he didn't die. He's a rather enigmatic entity insofar as we're given very little information about him. We just know that he has a couple of verses in Genesis 5. And of course, we know that he walked with God and all of that good stuff. But the problem with all of this is that there are so many pieces to this story that you all don't know, that if I start to tell you some of the deeper parts, I lose you because I have to redefine what you believe. So when you look through all of these different stories that you're going to find out as we go through the Nephilim and the Pyramid of the Apocalypse, and we talk about where the Nephilim lived, and then we talk about the Brotherhood, because I still have to break down the Brotherhood, because the Brotherhood is the part that has most people confused. Like when we're talking about from Seth to Noah, let me break this down. See, in Genesis chapter 5, each person that's mentioned from the time of Seth to the time of Noah walked with God. They literally walked with Yahweh. And most were teachers of his word. You can look in Jude 14. It's going to tell us. They talk about Enoch in Jude 14. It says that Enoch, he was the seventh from Adam. So he was seven generations from Adam. Okay. He was a teacher. They say he walked with Yahweh for 300 years. He walked. He was hanging out. He didn't just scoop down and get him. They walked for 300 years. How many people walking like this? Y'all don't understand. It said that he walked with him faithfully. That's why he made him the scribe. Now, what happened to him in the end? Y'all could debate that all day. But then you got to look at the godly line of Seth. Now, it's going to be hard for some people to get. So let me try to make, I'm simplifying this, not for all you learned students out there, but for regular folks that's just trying to keep up with the story, okay? Now, could Enoch have been taken away to save his life? Perhaps those who had been with him in his walk with Yah was now falling away, and they was being corrupted by the influence of Satan's world. And this was caused by the breakdown of the separation between the godly line of Seth and the godless line of Cain. Okay, Cain went ahead and followed a whole generation. He put a whole bloodline out there. Okay, remember when I taught y'all about Sheol? In Sheol, there's three different groups of souls. You got the souls, the very first group are the righteous. And those are the ones that remember when he gave them the tour, he said, what is all of that noise that's reaching all the way up to heaven? He said, those are the peoples whose prayers haven't been avenged. The blood hasn't been avenged yet for the murder of Abel. So those are the righteous ones. And if you live the righteous life and you wanted to chosen and elect, remember, that's where your soul sits until judgment. Everybody gonna sit. Ain't nobody smiling down on shit. Ain't nobody got no harps yet. Ain't nobody got their wings. Some people, ain't nobody in the pitchfork and the flames ain't got fired up yet. Everybody is in wait mode. It's the boringest shit in the world. And remember what we taught you. Your group by, there's three groups. You got the righteous group over here. That's the group you hope you end up in. That's where you hope you end up in. But then you got the middle group. The middle group is, y'all know y'all did that shit. That's that crew. They said, all y'all going to be together. You're going to be with your like kind. So if you was a thief, you're going to be with all the thieves. If you was a liar, you're going to be with all the liars. If you was a fornicator, you're going to be with all the fornicators. If you was a murderer, you're going to be with all the murderers. But the last group is the group that actually intermingled with the spirits of the Nephilim. Those ones who involved themselves with the demon spirits of the fallen angels. Those people are kept in a third section because they say their punishment going to be completely, they shit going to be like by the book. Dude going to walk through and be like, well, it says right here that, you know, we're going to have to, you guys, they're going to go to the book on them. There'll be no mercy. So the lines of Seth and Cain was broken. Because it was written, it says, when you choose some of their daughters as wives for your sons and their daughters prostitute themselves to their gods, they will lead your sons to do the same. That's in the book of Exodus somewhere. It specifically says in the book of Deuteronomy. I'm not making this up. We're just doing an investigation. Don't think that that's all we do here at Facts Over Feelings is dig into the word. We dig into any topic that we want to get to the meat and potatoes of without being biased. So don't come in here with your feelings all standing up talking about, I can't believe he's preaching like that. I'm not your preacher. I am a teacher. See, a preacher proclaims, but a teacher explains. And I am simply explaining. So fix your face, fix yourself, sit down, take some notes and put something in your head. It says in the book of Deuteronomy, it says, do not intermarry with them. Do not give your daughters to their sons or take their daughters from your sons, for they will turn your children away from following me to serve other gods. And Yah's anger will burn against you and will quickly destroy you. He's basically saying you ain't supposed to be intermarrying. You ain't supposed to be mixing bloodlines with certain individuals, because once that blood gets in your DNA, now it controls your spirit. DNA gives access to the soul. That's why do you think they trying to study DNA so hard? They didn't give a damn about DNA in the 50s. They had Dragnet. They didn't give a damn about DNA in the 70s. They had Starsky and Hutch. They didn't give a damn about DNA in 1990. They had Hawk. See, I'm telling y'all, didn't nobody care about all of that. Now, all of a sudden, they got a DNA profile on anything and everything that happened. It's nonstop forensic files around here. They studying DNA. They're studying the source of melanin. They want to know what the key is. Why? Because DNA is nothing more than the code. But it is not the electricity that drives it. And since they can't figure out the electricity, which is melanin, they figure they can control the programming. Like a Frankenstein, they can direct it. But oh, if they only realize that the 6 trillion pieces of code in one strand of DNA, if you change just one thing, it will affect so many other things. You have no idea what creature you are about to unleash into the earth realm. Something that probably was on the forbidden list. Something that should never have walked the face of the earth. And your dumb ass will be the one to sit there and unleash it. Am I my brother's keeper? This has been Facts Over Feelings. Friday night, I'm going to see y'all back for the second half. Got a few things to talk about. Facts Over Feelings. The Nephilim and the Pyramid of the Apocalypse. I'm Grandmaster J. I'll see y'all in 5 minutes.